I'm honored to join my colleagues from nations that represent our great religion and ancient civilizations. I stand here as a representative of a land that has been for ages a fountain of knowledge, a beacon of peace, a source of faiths and traditions, home to many religions, and now one of the major economies of the world. I carry the greetings of my Prime Minister, Shri Narendra Modi ji, and 1.3 billion Indians, including more than 185 million Muslim brothers and sisters. Our Muslim brothers and sisters are a microcosm of the diversity of India. They speak Tamil and Telugu, Malayalam and Marathi, Bangla and Bhojpuri, and any of the numerous languages of India. They have diverse culinary tastes, myriad choices of traditional attire, and they maintain strong cultural and linguistic heritage of the regions they love and they have lived for generations. They practice their respective beliefs and live in harmony with each other and with their non-Muslim brethren. It is this appreciation of diversity and coexistence that has ensured that very few Muslims in India have fallen prey to the poisonous propaganda of radical and extremist ideologies. Your Highness and Excellencies, 2019 is indeed a very special year. In this year, the OIC is celebrating its golden jubilee, the United Arab Emirates is celebrating Year of Tolerance, and India is celebrating the 150th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi, a global symbol of truth and non-violence. It is therefore a matter of pride for me and for India to be invited in this special year to be your guest of honor and to be extended a hand of friendship. I convey my deep appreciation to Foreign Minister, His Highness Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed, for his sagacious leadership and for his invitation. Thank you, Your Highness. Your Highness and Excellencies, in the past 4 years, few relationships have seen as much engagement as India's relationship with the UAE and indeed with the entire Gulf and West Asia region. It is a return of history. UAE has shown how a nation can power its progress with a grand vision, with the openness of the world, with an embrace of technology, with investment in human resources, and with an environment that nurtures talent and cultures from around the world. We also express our special gratitude to Saudi Arabia, Bangladesh, and other friends for their strong support for hearing India's voice in this forum. Your Highness and Excellencies, the OIC member constitute more than 1/4 of the members of the United Nations and nearly a quarter of the humanity. It is an organization that has a key role in shaping our world. It brings together nations on the foundation of a common faith, but also by a shared desire for a better future for their people. From Southeast Asia to the shores of Latin America, from the steppes of Central Asia to the vast expanse of the African continent, from South Asia to the great arc of West Asia and North Africa, the nations represented here also reflect a magnificent diversity of language and literature, customs and culture, history and heritage. Your Highness, Excellencies, India shares much with you. Many of us have experienced the dark days of colonialism. Many of us saw the light of freedom and the bright ray of hope at the same time. We have stood together in solidarity in our quest for justice, dignity, and equality of all people, regardless of race and religion. We have worked together to fashion global institutions into representative platforms, defined not by the interest of a few, but the voice of all sections of humanity. We have together struggled for a world where access to resources, markets, and opportunities is fair and balanced. And with so many nations here, India has forged deep bonds of friendship and close partnership. Friends, as India's economy has grown, and become more integrated with the world, these partnerships have become stronger. We have excellent political ties marked by warmth, respect, and goodwill. With many, we have expanding defense and security cooperation. Our economic engagement is robust and growing rapidly. Our digital partnerships are shaping the course of our future, and our ties have the warm glow of deepening human and cultural links. Nations to our east, Brunei, Indonesia, and Malaysia, are important pillars of India's Act East policy and of our broader engagement in the Indo-Pacific region. In our neighborhood, with Afghanistan, Bangladesh, and Maldives, we have ties forged in our shared struggles and sacrifices, in the immeasurable warmth of our hearts, and in our unwavering commitment to the security and prosperity of our people and region. In Central Asia, where human aspirations linked us across the mightiest mountains since ancient times, we are rebuilding our relationship along new routes of possibilities. We do this especially with and through Iran, a country with which we not only share civilizational and cultural links, but a partnership that is vital for stability and prosperity in our region. In West Asia, our solidarity with the aspirations of the Palestinian people have remained unwavering. Our international journey was often pursued in close partnership with Egypt. Iraq and India have stood together in our triumphs and trials. We have, with great admiration, supported Jordan's efforts in strengthening the voices of moderation and building bridges of understanding between faiths. Further to the west, with nations like Tunisia, Morocco, and Algeria, we work for a shared desire for a more inclusive world. With Turkey, a nation with which we have many strands of connected history, we are imparting new momentum to our ties. Our many friends from Africa are here. It is a friendship of deep emotional bond that comes from shared struggle for freedom and for a voice and a place in the world. Today, on the foundations of that extraordinary heritage, India and Africa have launched a new partnership of prosperity in the dynamic African continent. And here in our neighborhood of the Gulf region, our relationships are as old as time. The tides of Arabian seas have carried forth our timeless links of trade, culture, and religions. Presently, the Gulf region is our largest market, supplier of energy, and source of remittances. More than 8 million Indians living in the region are the 8 million vibrant threads of this partnership. But now our relationship is much more than that. Thanks to the extraordinary effort and attention by Prime Minister Narendra Modi and the leadership of the region. It is an indispensable strategic and security partnership and a natural economic partnership of immense value to our nations and for our shared region. Your Highness and Excellencies, today we all live in a world of sweeping changes and multiple challenges that happen but rarely in history. We see global shifts in power. The center of gravity of the global economy is moving to Asia. The international order we are familiar with is changing. Freedom, opportunities, connectivity, health, education, and prosperity are more widespread than ever before. The time it takes nations to lift people out of poverty is getting shorter. Digital revolution has created unprecedented opportunities to empower people and transform our economies. We have affordable and accessible technologies that give us hope for a sustainable energy future. Yet, we also live on the edge of uncertainties. Tensions, turbulence, disputes, violence, dislocation, displacement are also at a high. Conflicts within and between societies are rising. We are also seeing the human and economic costs of climate change. And we are witnessing the terrible daily destruction in senseless terrorist violence. It is destroying lives, destabilizing regions, and putting the world at great peril. The reach of terror is growing. Its lethality is increasing, and the toll it is taking is rising. in the rich diversity of Southeast Asia, in West Asia and the Gulf, in North Africa and Sahel region, in Europe and North America, in Afghanistan, Bangladesh and India, we see the terrible face of terror. Excellencies and Your Highness, terrorism and extremism bear different names and labels. It uses diverse causes, but in each case, it is driven by distortion of religion and a misguided belief in its power to succeed. The fight against terrorism is not a confrontation against any religion. It cannot be. Just as Islam literally means peace, none of the 99 names of Allah mean violence. Similarly, every region in the world stands for peace, compassion, and brotherhood. There is a verse in the Holy Quran which says, La ikra fi ad-deen. Let there be no compulsion in religion. There is another surah, Al-Hajurat, which says, O mankind, we created you from a single pair of male and female and made you into nations and tribes so that you may know one another, not that you may despise one another. Similarly, the same message was given by the founder guru of Sikhism, Guru Nanak Dev Ji, when he says, and I quote, Avval Allah noor upaya, kudrat ke sab bande, ek noor te sab jag upjya, kaun pale ko mande. This means, first Allah created light. Then by his creative power, he made all mortal beings. From that one light, the entire world came into being. So who is good and who is bad? Your Highness and Excellencies, India has always embraced and found it easy to embrace pluralism, since it is embedded in the oldest Sanskrit religious text, the Rig Veda, and I quote, Ekam sadvipra bahuda vadanti, which means, God is one, but learned men describe him in many ways. Our great philosopher Swami Vivekananda said that this phrase from the Rig Veda has given the theme to all subsequent thoughts to India, and one that will be the theme of the whole world of religions. Your Highness and Excellencies, this is not a clash of civilizations or cultures, but a contest of ideas and ideals. As Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi has often said, it is a struggle between the values of humanism and the forces of inhumanity. Your Highness and Excellencies, if we want to save the humanity, then we must tell the states who provide shelter and funding to the terrorists to dismantle the infrastructure of their terrorist camps and stop providing funding and shelter to the terror organizations based in that country. At the same time, I would like to say that this menace cannot be fought only through military, intelligence, or diplomatic means. It is also a battle that must be won through the strengths of our values and the real message of religions. This is a task that states, societies, sages, scholars, spiritual leaders, and families must pursue through personal contacts and on social media. And for this, faiths must speak to faiths. Cultures must engage with cultures. Communities must build bridges, not erect walls. The youth must shape the future, not destroy lives. Your Highness and Excellencies, I'm particularly pleased to participate in a conference whose theme is a roadmap for prosperity and development. However, I may enter a caveat. The young are not going to be content with only roadmaps. They want roads as well. They also want them to be built fast. It must be our common objective to ensure that we leave them a world that is infinitely better in terms of equitable economic growth and social justice than the one we inherited. That is the mission which has brought us together in Abu Dhabi, a city that has matured into a landmark of Asia and the world. Your Highness and Excellencies, India is the world's third largest economy on purchasing power parity and is the fastest growing one. We are prepared to share our market, resources, opportunities and skills with our partners. We will do what we can within our capacity to ensure that the path to development remains open to all and the global trade regime is open, stable and fair. Your Highness and Excellencies, at 50, Organization of Islamic States is making a new beginning. The choices you make, the directions you set, will have a profound impact on humanity.